All right, we're live.
Great. Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Christine Moutier with the American Foundation for Suicide Prevention, and I get to join Jackie Padilla today with NowThis to talk about stress and relationships during this time of COVID.
I'm so glad that we're back on this chat. I know we took a break last week, but I have been looking forward to this conversation for quite some time, mostly because so many people from our viewers and our audience have been reaching out, wondering how the heck we maintain and grow and even start relationships in lockdown. So I would just love to kick off the conversation with kind of an obvious one that our audience has been dealing with, and that's love in lockdown. I've seen so many relationships blossom and so many new relationships come to fruition via apps and social media and video calls. What do you think about that? Is that a healthy decision to be making?
I actually think it's a great thing. If you think about sort of in a way like system theory, right now, COVID meant disruption, and that can have really negative implications for many of us. It can also have positive implications because it means we hit a reset button and we have to do things differently. And maybe some of these new relationships are coming about because you're connecting to different groups of people or reaching out in different ways, or introductions are being made, even virtually. Whereas in our normal day-to-day lives, frankly, so many of us got so busy that we weren't even allowing space and time for those kind of new connections to be made. So anyway, I don't see anything wrong with that at all. And in fact, I think sometimes going through hard circumstances or even like traumatizing circumstances together is a way to actually build truly meaningful bonds together.
Is maybe jumping on a dating app or reaching out to people on social media necessarily a good answer if you're feeling a sense of loneliness or isolation, especially if you live at home, alone rather?
Yeah, and I think it really depends on your own personal experience with what you're finding in the different apps or modalities that you're using. I think you have to be careful because not everything is going to be the right fit or the right time. And not every interaction is going to mean that that particular platform is like altogether not for you either. It could just mean that it was a unique one-off and to keep trying. But the way I look at it is if we can trust our own instincts about what happens inside of us with the different people in our lives, environments, apps, that can truly guide us because when you're gaining a sense of like improvement in your mental health, you feel more grounded, you feel less preoccupied, your mind is able to actually calm and center. And in certain relationships, you find that you find that feeling more often than in other relationships. And I think that's something that we could actually use as a guide.
What are the pros or cons of starting a relationship that, is kind of laid on this foundation of pure two people that are struggling with all of the things that this pandemic encompasses?
Well, it might mean that the individuals are kind of naturally able to just disclose more, like a more authentic sharing and a deeper sharing of the human experience that you're having right now. And the truth is that the best relationships probably evolve in different ways, but that when they reach a point of more authentic, honest disclosure, that is what we tend to find more meaningful. And when there's like a sense of trust that builds because the person on the receiving end, you're finding like isn't judging you, but maybe quite the opposite, is like actually interested and can tolerate that we're all maybe struggling with different things at different times, like that's just a part of reality. That kind of experience of affirmation and even just tolerance of life being messy and hard at times, I think that's a really important thing and does take relationships kind of to a deeper level, while all the other usual things of like chemistry and physical connection or, you know, common interests, those are of course important too. But I almost wonder if that deeper way of developing trust is in some ways in like normal circumstances, be, you know, pre-COVID, it's kind of like harder to come by for some at least.
So is there a right answer in terms of who to turn to when you're feeling these moments of loneliness or isolation? Is it ideal to try and find another partner or someone you already know, be it your a family member or a friend? Or does that just go case by case?
I think it's really case by case. I mean, I think there are many people who have their go-to trusted people. And look, I think the reality is for any of us who may seem like you know everybody and you're connected to everybody, the truth is there's usually an inner circle of just a few people who are the ones that you would turn to, especially if you're struggling. And that's a normal, healthy thing. The important thing is to have at least one. And, you know, so I guess part of what I'm saying is don't worry if you're not somebody who has 8 or 10 people that you would trust to go to with those really tougher circumstances. You know, I think finding a new partner or a new friend is entirely feasible for some, but probably beyond the scope of what a lot of people would feel able or comfortable doing right now. And sort of like all of that is okay. Again, as long as you're finding that you are able to find someone who cares, who, you know, if you share that you're having a tough time with whatever it is, you know, something at home or finances or a work situation, that they catch that and that they're able to hear it. And sometimes actually, I think in relationships, sometimes it's okay to actually tell the person what you need. Like, I think we're all such natural problem solvers that it's an instinct for people to be like, well, you should do this. And if that's not what you needed in that moment, it's okay to say, you know, I appreciate your sharing that, your wisdom, your experience with, you know, problem solving and stuff. But actually what I need right now is just to be heard and for you to take an interest in what my experience is like. And that's it. That's all you need to do. So anyway, yeah, it's probably different for different people based on those things.
And there's one side of a relationship blossoming and there's another side of relationships that already exist, whether that be for partners already living together or say you went back to mom and dad's house. How do you keep these relationships healthy if you need them to, you know, mentally be okay and to talk things out, but also not oversaturate that time that you have together? I think I've heard from quite a few people that it can also come with, you know, some overbearing, overwhelming feelings as well. So where's that healthy balance for us to not get overwhelmed?
Yeah, and I think that is such a great point. And it depends on the nature of like where the relationship was at baseline too, and what you're accustomed to being able to share with each other. But again, because of the newness of the circumstance and being maybe sheltering in place together, there are some opportunities there. But I am finding for myself and my own network of colleagues and friends and family that there is an element of everyone feeling some degree of increased stress, and that stress load can affect your health, your brain, your body. You can feel more exhausted. Your frustration tolerance can be thinner. Irritability tends to, you know, crop up more. And so I think just realizing that everyone is under that kind of strain. You know, if you went home and you're with your parents, there's a good chance they're feeling stress load related to whatever it is they're dealing with, whether it's financial or health concerns or other things. And just to be aware of kind of the balance of things. Like, I think both opening up opportunities so that you can connect and have your own internal experiences be met and processed is important, but you can also be there for them. And that's the most beautiful thing that we can do for each other in a really healthy relationship, is have that kind of give and take. And because of the stress and the circumstances, I would just say having an extra dose of compassion and kind of grace and forgiveness ready to go for ourselves, for sure, but also in our relationships with others is just so needed right now. You know, it goes a long way for the other person to hear that it's okay, that there was a tension that developed and some friction, and that we can forgive each other and move past that. Everyone's having a bit of a hard time right now.
And I know just through my conversations with AFSP, we've talked about the importance of recognizing if someone's an introvert or an extrovert, but along the same lines, it's also really important to remember our circumstances. You know, how do we handle it if person A has their job and is still doing okay and is for the most part, you know, mentally put together and considered stable, and another person who might be furloughed or without a job and is struggling to handle all this, and you're seeing both in the same corridors? How do you address that with both people having a healthy conversation?
Yeah. Oh gosh. There's an every variation on that theme of even like thinking about even if people have more similar circumstances, but you just cope differently during a time like this. And it could be polar opposite differently. Like one person's idea of, you know, refueling is just like vegging on the couch, watching shows. And the other person is to go into a swirl storm of cleaning and organizing or gardening or whatever. And I think the main thing is to, in a way, you could frame it as a boundaries issue, to think about that you have your instincts and your well-being to take care of, and to encourage and allow others to be doing their thing and processing their stress in the way that they know how, rather than to get into a cycle of, kind of projecting your own instincts for what works for you onto others. That can create a lot of tension in relationships, because not everybody is gonna need the same things and cope the same way. And there's a whole, there's not a right or wrong. You know, there's, the fact is we're all probably doing basically the best that we can, and we'll probably do better if we just show each other some support and encouragement rather than like, you should be doing it this way.
How do you anticipate these relationships once, you know, lockdowns are alleviated and we go back to some sort of sense of normalcy? I think we've kind of been forced now to have more conversations, reach out more, solidify more of a stronger foundation. And, you know, these new romantic relationships that we're mentoring, or these new relationships with whoever we decide to reach out to, how do we make sure that we're building something healthy that can withstand normalcy after the fact?
Yeah, it's such a like an intriguing thing to think about, really. To me, it's having an awareness that as things progress, as time goes by and our activities shift back into possibly more of the normal range of things that we're doing in our social circles. I mean, if you have started a new relationship, just the awareness that that you may have some choices to make along the way, that if it's a relationship that has become very valuable to you, that, you know, acknowledging that those shifts are going to be taking place in both of each other's lives, and kind of like how to just stay on the same page about that and be respectful and communicate. You know, communication is always the key, but kind of like that awareness that those changes are going to happen. And for some, it might be that the relationship doesn't last because it was kind of, it fit the circumstance of the time, but wasn't able to kind of evolve and shift into a more kind of diverse landscape of life as usual. But if it's important to the individuals and it's healthy and valuable, then you can absolutely find a way to do that. And about the question of the sort of deeper disclosures that many of us are doing right now, and that is such a wonderful thing. It's terrible that it had to be driven by like such a sense of anxiety and fear and loneliness. But on the other hand, that as a disrupting force has allowed many of us to share and to try new things. And we just did a poll of the American public at AFSP, and we found that there's something like the majority of people are actually reaching out to people in new ways that they hadn't before, to share about some experience of their well-being or mental health. And of those who are doing those reach outs and that level of disclosure and communication, about 3/4 are saying it helped them. And that is consistent with the science around just the power of human connection and healthy communication and really like connecting at that more deep human level. So I hope that will be something that we experience really quite naturally, but also like take notice of it and realize that just because life may go back to that routine of more normalcy, that we can still take that with us. That is an incredible thing. And we actually do have to kind of be more proactive about it, because it's not always that relationships just afford that level of deeper communication naturally. Like there is a way to actually steer it in that direction.
I think my last question for you before we wrap up today is that communication with kids. I think we're seeing so many young children not really sure why we're not, you know, going to grandma's house or going inside and giving someone a hug. What is your best advice to anyone out there who's trying to explain everything that's going on that's kid friendly, or to someone who's just not really understanding why normal, again, isn't what we're experiencing in daily life?
Yeah, it is really hard on especially younger kids or kids who already had, you know, any kind of learning issues or mental health struggles to begin with. And especially for young children too, where these changes are not really that graspable. And so, and even really young kids can't necessarily articulate their questions and their stress in the way that older kids and adults hopefully do for the most part. So they're going to show and demonstrate their distress. And that, of course, stresses out parents, because it looks like, you know, disruptive or behavior that's problematic. And it is something to address. But remember that sometimes behaviors come from a place of fear or sadness or hurt, and particularly with younger children. So I think, you know, just giving them a space to express themselves verbally as much as possible, really listening to them. And just by doing that, it shows them and it teaches them that it's okay and it's actually encouraged to use words to express the hard feelings that we have. That's a powerful lesson that I think if all of us had that experience as kids, to be able to do that, that's a processing that can allow those feelings not to take root and have more significant and longer lasting effects. It's a way to process trauma just by being able to use words to communicate through that. So, I mean, I think that on top of all the usual, like help them to structure their time, help them to stay connected, really provide kids and especially young kids a lot of reassurance. They don't need every last detail of, you know, the CDC updates on what's happening related to COVID. They need to know the basics, and that by following these guidelines, they are helping the family to stay safe. They're helping the whole community to stay safe, and that they will go back to activities at a later time. Maybe a fun thing to do would be if they like to think about the future, like plan something for the future that they can look forward to. I think we all need that right now too, to just, it's such a time meld that we're in. It's kind of disorienting. So thinking about like, what are those things in the distant future that you're really looking forward to, and let yourself kind of just like plan around that a little bit.
Definitely. Well, communication's key, I think, is the most important factor from this conversation. And again, I just really appreciate you taking time to chat with me and discuss all these things that tie into our mental health. And of course, you know, the bigger reason of why we're speaking today is making sure everyone remembers that they're not alone if they are feeling lonely or isolated or want to start a new relationship. And really, to me, and tell me if you agree, that's the most important thing, is to make sure that everyone remembers that we're all feeling the same things, even though it can feel a bit distant.
100% true. I mean, I think that's been part of the powerful piece of like this sense of we're part of a community together, this community cohesion that we should keep on finding ways to remember exactly what you're saying, that you're not in this alone. We are in this together, and reach out and find somebody if you don't have that person who is compassionate and is takes an interest in your experience. We all need that, and you can give that back to others as well.
Well, again, thank you so much for taking time to chat today. I always appreciate our conversations. And for anyone watching, if you do need to reach out for anything with support, you can please call the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline at 800-273-8255, or you can contact the crisis text line by texting TALK to 741-741.
Thanks, Jackie.